Hi everyone, today we're here with Kevin Hogan and he has made the time on his busy schedule. He's here in for boot camp in Las Vegas, yay, to come and spend some time and talk with us. And most of you know that Kevin Hogan is a leading authority in persuasion, body language, NLP, hypnotherapy, tinnitus, you name it, he knows it all. Hi Kevin.
Hey, it's good to see you. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well. I'm sorry that you're ill, but you see,
I'm a little under the weather, but you can't tell,
good.
Can you?
I can't tell at all.
I can't tell either, hardly.
I was going to tell you, I just got over the flu myself and it knocked me out for almost a week, but nothing can knock you down, can it?
Maybe for a couple hours, but when you got to go to work?
I was going to say.
You go and do it.
Now, you are extraordinary in that you do so much. You've knocked out 19 books already. When I wanted to list your products, I just gave up because there's a ton of products on so many different things. And you're also an NLP expert and you're also a neuroscience expert, body language expert, nonverbal communication expert, and the list goes on. So I'm so interested to talk to you today. Now, Ken, I know that you started out in Humble Beginnings in Chicago. And from there, you ended up making yourself an entrepreneur at an early age and going out and selling cards and doing jobs and stuff like that to help out with your family. Is that right?
Yeah, I grew up very much. Chicago had absolutely nothing. Yeah. Was very concerned on a daily basis of whether or not we'd go to an orphanage. My brothers and I would go to an orphanage.
How many brothers do you have?
Well, in this nuclear family, because there's a whole bunch of families. I have four dads and four moms.
Yeah.
So, but in this one, we had three brothers and two sisters. And that was the big thing. It was like, you know, people are like, oh, I'm broke, I don't have a job. And I'm like, I don't want to
hear
about
it. They don't understand, right?
You don't get, you know, are you 10 and taken off for the orphanage tomorrow morning?
Yeah.
Oh, you know, let's not whine. You know, it's like, you can do things.
Yeah.
So, yeah, things were challenging. And I, as life went on, it was always like, you know what? This experience is a foundation, right?
Mm-hmm.
It tells you, it's like, okay, you can live like this your whole life,
yeah,
or not.
I love that. Because you're also a motivational and inspirational speaker. But some of the times when you meet people that are a motivational or inspirational speaker, they don't really have anything else going on, and that's sort of the best they've got without any real tools. And what I like about you is you've got all the knowledge. You're a research buff. You do such a lot of research to prove everything that you talk about. Can you tell us a bit about that?
I was a geeky, well, I still am a geeky nerd.
Oh, you're not.
I am.
Interesting.
And I was just one of those kids who just loved, I was always like, in those days we didn't call it ADHD, but I could never keep my mind on one thing.
Yeah.
But every time I watched all my friends, like, they're here, then here, they wouldn't finish anything.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I was like, oh, I just started. Well, I'm like, that's stupid. Why would you do that?
Yeah.
You know, you can't make any money to pay. Well, they don't have. They didn't have to pay the.
Yeah.
Help pay the rent with their mom. So for me, it was like I would do 10 things at once, you know, and I just jump and hop back and forth, and it actually got pretty good at completing
That's awesome,
a whole bunch of different things, you know.
Because you know, you appear to me to be just somebody who's just very visual, very on it, very interested, but you've got everything down packed. You know, you can begin, you're creative, you like the process, and you finish too, which is sometimes difficult to find in people, right?
People always say, I'm an artist. They say, oh, so you're broke. Is that the deal?
Mm.
You know, the...
Not so much.
The difference between the difference between being an artist and having money is that the artist starts the concept, and then the completer, the person who finishes...
Mm-hmm.
ends up with all of the money. And they
can
be the same person, you know, but you have to create your piece of work and then let people know about it.
Oh, so much so. I mean, that's huge because I find that I have artists in my family too, and I find that artists sometimes become so attached to the process and the work that it's difficult to let go of it. I find it commendable and astonishing that you're able to have put together all three. And jumping to another subject quite quickly, which interests me so much, is that you're also now doing quite a bit of work with marketing, which I think is fantastic because you're seeing where you can position these patents in so many. You do medical stuff, in so many other areas.
There's some really... Right now we are in the toughest economy I've seen in my life.
Mm.
The toughest economy that people who are 85 have ever seen
in their
life.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, look what's happened in Vegas here. The houses are half.
Yeah.
And people do need to market, and right now business is not about having a great idea. Business is not about having a good product.
It's
right now business
truth.
Is about
yeah.
being able to let people know that what you have is good. Marketing is the whole business now. It is, you have to start with that concept in mind. And I don't think anybody truly enjoys going, "Hey, Mrs. Johnson, I'd like to show you my greeting cards, my Christmas cards."
Right.
Because it's work. Selling
right.
is work. But without selling, you don't have a job anymore.
Yeah.
If you can't market, you cannot have a job.
I think people are beginning to realize that more and more so now, but there still is that fear of the approach, isn't there? I'm reading The Game at the moment, and I love that book.
Neil Strauss, he's genius.
Isn't he? But he's just such a beautiful writer. But what I'm finding is that guys have had that issue too with approaching women and so on, even as pickup artists, which a lot of women may think, ugh, you know, weasels, right? But that fear of the approach of beginning something and going into new territory is very real in lots of different areas in life, right?
Do you have women that watch? Do you have a female audience?
Yes.
You know, the guys, here's the deal, or gals, or my mom didn't teach
girls.
Me politically correctly. She said, you always open a door for a woman, and my mom was not the, you don't talk back to a woman ever. So it's like,
Your mom was right.
You know, you open the door, she yells at you, and you can't say anything.
Right.
You know, and now you want to change this? Think about it. But anyhow, so the pickup artist, I mean, to some degree, it's kind of like, oh, yuck. But at the same time,
it's not, it's so cool.
If you think about it.
Way cool.
It's like, don't you want to be the person who... I mean, or would you rather be the person who is over there and nobody wants to come talk to you?
Absolutely.
You know? And I love to be seduced.
Yeah. I think we all do, don't we?
I think.
It makes you feel, you know,
it makes you feel good.
Popular, somebody's interested.
Stalk me, please, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know?
Yeah.
It's kind of cool. It's like, that person is interested enough in this picture.
Right.
You know, this package to be following me.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, it's got weird. There's weird people. I've met a lot of them. But there's some pretty cool people out there,
definitely.
Too. So.
Definitely. And I think, well, you know, I know that we're not talking about the pickup artist, but what I've got from it so far by reading Neil Strauss's book is that the whole project was started because there were so many men that weren't getting dates. They weren't getting attention. It wasn't set up to, you know, get over on women necessarily. You know, some people, obviously, with any subject are going to use it for different means. But it's just a way for men to build more confidence and actually have a plan, right?
You know, if we are so scared, we are so terrified that, hi, would you like to go out to dinner tonight? Mm. No. And then my life is crushed, right?
Right.
And we men are terrified of rejection.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
And we just can't handle it. And because we're in that position to where we're sort of the searcher, the aggressor usually, it's hard. And so really, even if whatever, you know, the guy teaches all of his guys at the group that night, even if it was total BS, even if it was all totally unscientific and it was totally not true, the placebo effect, I learned all that stuff. Now I'll go say, hey, Nadia, you want to go to dinner or whatever? And you'll go, oh, yes, and I believe it.
Yes.
And then as soon as I have confidence and certainty in myself, then all of a sudden you become more interested because we see people all day who are either wishy-washy or they're confident, but they're overconfident, arrogant, right?
Yeah.
You know, and women hate arrogance.
Yeah.
Probably more than anything in the world is arrogance and wishy-washiness, the two sides of the spectrum. Women like a confident, certain person that they go, oh, you know what? He's got it together. Because that's the person who succeeds. The person who's overconfident jumps out of the window and goes, psh, I shouldn't have done that. Right? And the wishy-washy person goes, I don't know what to do.
Yeah.
Right? So that's what they're looking for. And that's why, and this is true in all marketing or anything you do, you want to have that right amount of confidence.
Just right.
That certainty.
Now, is that difficult to get to, Kevin? Do you teach that?
I don't know. It's a hard thing to teach. Mm.